Welcome to Around Space. I'm Kent Miller. Today we're going to be talking about space art. You've seen textbooks and science fiction books and movies that all require space art. It turns out there's not a lot of people in the world who can do this kind of work well. There's maybe about 145 in the whole world. I'm delighted to have one of them with us, David Robinson. He's a member of the International Association of Astronomical Artists since about 2003. He's exhibited his artwork, for example, at the International Space Development Conference, at least four times that I know of. He's published at least with nine publishers, including Oxford Publishing, Blackwell Publishing, National Geographic, Smithsonian, HarperCollins. His work appears on several websites, including space.com. The National Space Society has a website, NSS.com. He has a whole gallery there. His art also appears on the Mars Society's webpage as well. He's also looking out for the next generation. The National Space Society has a space art competition for students. So he's one of the judges for that every year. So welcome back to this show.
Thank you, Ken. Appreciate that. And this year we're going to kind of a smorgasbord of
taking art. Us on a trip through the solar system.
Yeah, absolutely. Right. And a lot of hardware in this one, starting out with what I consider one of my spaceships that I designed. Is called the USS Cumberland.
Okay. Now, Cumberland is a river in Virginia.
Yes, it is.
Okay.
Yeah, it seems like a lot of my things are named after either terrain or objects or towns or what have you in Virginia.
Okay.
Yeah. A lot of the history for my country has started in Virginia.
Yeah, yeah.
Absolutely. So, like I say, this is shows just a the Cumberland in deep space. Just whatever light is the sun is hitting it at a great distance past Mars, probably past the asteroid belt.
What I think is nice about this picture is you really do see how stark the shadows are.
Yes.
It's, you know, in the film industry, you have key and fill, right?
Right.
You can backlight something to but in space you don't have that.
That's correct.
Right.
And I try to do a little more realistic view of it. So it makes it a little harder for people to see the detail, but I think the shadows definitely adds realism to it.
Yeah, and we see the antenna on the in the middle of the photograph pointed back towards presumably Earth.
Yes.
So it's lit by the sun.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So you're out about Jupiter distance with this guy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's actually hitting, this one is heading towards Saturn. That's its destination.
Oh, okay.
So.
Sweet.
Right, and then the next image we have is just a lander. It's the Olympus. It's a Mars lander.
All right. Well, you've done much more than that. You've built a whole landscape here.
Mm-hmm.
And even it looks like a dust storm. That's you got a busy sky there.
Absolutely. And this is actually this lander was attached to another ship that was aimed after something very special to me. It was a ship called the USS Shenandoah from Shenandoah Valley in Virginia.
Well, let's just stop for a moment because the software you're using was originally designed as a landscaping.
That's correct. It's specifically for terrains and things of that nature.
Right.
And most people I know that use the software, they basically import most of their models. They'll buy them or they'll build them in a different program and then import them into this program. I myself use just the basic geometry that comes with this program to build the models in the actual program itself. So this is all native model building in the program itself.
That's very impressive. I see you have three astronauts taking a walk there.
Yeah. And just the terrain, like I say, most of my projects, I will render, depending on the project, anywhere from at least two or 300 different pictures.
Yeah.
And there are probably a good 100 pictures that deals with this ship and various terrain configurations. Mm-hmm. And as I was going through, I just found something that kind of fit my, I guess, fancy for this time, and I want to...
Well, there's a certain realism here. I mean, mm-hmm. you don't want to land in a rocky terrain.
That's right? Correct, yeah.
You don't want one leg to be sitting on a boulder that rolls over.
Well, you'd be surprised, you know, sometimes yeah. you would actually end up landing. Sometimes you really have no choice in where you end up landing, depending on... If everything goes perfect to plan, mm-hmm. you know, mm-hmm. then, yeah, you always land where you need to land. Other times, things happen beyond your control. You may have some malfunctions, some systems mm-hmm. go down. But for the most part, you definitely want to land on something that's flat and right. Less...
I guess the engineers wanted you to stay away from boulders and yeah. slopes and high-speed winds.
That is correct, yeah. And hopefully the way this ship was designed, it gives a lot yeah. more leverage so that it would be a pretty high wind that would knock this one over.
Yeah.
You know, if you have real high ships and the landing gear doesn't spread that wide apart, mm-hmm. then... depending on the wind. And winds can pick up quite dramatically on Mars.
Yes, indeed.
It could knock something over. So if it gets to a certain velocity,
then... This one doesn't use parachutes.
No. No, it actually has four main engines on the bottom.
A little hard to see, yeah.
Yeah,
they're in the shadow there.
Yeah, they're actually recessed back into the bottom part of the engine.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Because there was a shell that actually these landing gears were retracted mm-hmm. into these casings, and then there was a shell, a heat shield, that as it entered the atmosphere, that was ejected, and then
right.
the engines fired.
That makes sense.
Yep.
That's a sweet picture.
Yeah.
And then, oh, my. Now, that's next one is Jupiter, right?
Yeah, Jupiter, and actually it's looking back from Europa at Jupiter. And
now, Europa is that ice-covered... moon.
That right? is correct.
With lots of cracks on the surface.
Absolutely, a lot of cracks. And I did the terrain from this and the deep texture editor and Bryce to create the...
Bryce is your software.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. To create the texture I wanted for the landscape that you see in front of you. Also, you can see in the background near the red eye of Jupiter, you can see Io, and actually Io has at least three volcanoes gone off. They're actually...
A little hard to see.
Yeah, exactly.
It's pixel size.
I know. And then there's a little lander between the canyons itself that's uh-huh. Hitting towards the front.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah.
Very nice. Now, this is not just a paste job. This is mm-hmm. all rendered...
Yeah, all run at the same time.
All the same. So all yep. the shadows are consistent.
All the shadows are consistent, exactly. Yeah. Yeah, so exactly how it would look.
This is very impressive.
Yeah.
Oh, there, now we're landed.
Yes. Now, this is a different lander, by the way, than the one we just saw on this page.
Okay.
And this one basically just shows possibly what the terrain would look like. And again, you want to land in a flat surface as right. as flat as you possibly could make it. There was a couple of movies, one out called, it was a movie about Europa and a manned mission there. Mm-hmm. And one of the things that I found odd was the fact that once they landed on Europa that... it was extremely cold, obviously, and the engine and the landing gear for the bottom of the ship was so close to the surface that the engines froze up. And when they tried to basically take off from the planet surface, that the lines to fed the fuel lines remained frozen, so they got up about 2,000 or 3,000 feet, and then they crashed back in.
Oh dear.
To the surface, and I would made sure, well, no, that's not going to happen this time.
Well, I think the assumption in that film is that the lander was a single stage vehicle.
Yes, and mine's a dual stage.
Which is a lot safer.
Absolutely, yeah, because everybody's going to get, it's basically based on the same premise as the moon lander.
Right, which is also two-stage.
Exactly. And so the ascent stage, you know, it doesn't matter, but A.
Yeah. Well, that's very nice. This is, now there's a rough terrain there.
Yep, and that was, again, another terrain done in a deep texture editor and Bryce. And, yeah, it takes a while to get used to using this editor and to try all different types of textures and things like that to you, and then render an image, just showing you, you know, the terrain field to see what it looks like and see if it really matches something that you think you could use. And after about, what was a good 15 to 20 variations on textures, till I finally came across something that I felt comfortable with. And I wanted to basically kind of give it, add it so it's almost like quartz, shot quartz. Like when a meteor hits, that's what it produces.
It has that crumbled, rugged, eroded.
Exactly.
It's and, many things together.
And the distance in the background, you see Saturn, and so this would be Iapetus, that would be a crater.
It has almost like a granite-like color to it.
Yeah.
That's amazing landscape work there. Yeah.
And then we got another one. This is another space vehicle. This is called the Savannah.
Okay.
You know, well, I went down south. I went to South Carolina.
Oh yeah,
Again,
we have those stark shadows that you would see in space.
Exactly, and this one has a micrometeor shield in the front protect the ship, because moving at these high speeds, you hit anything, and it's not going to be a little damage done. It will go through the entire vehicle.
Right, so the idea is that you vaporize the micrometeorite on the shield.
That's correct.
So at most, gas hits whatever's behind it.
Right, yeah. And then you also have a return vehicle in front that the astronauts will be turning to,
I guess we see the nozzle sticking up, nozzle sticking up.
That's exactly it.
All right, it's over on the left.
That's correct.
Okay, nice.
And now we have the Cumberland at Saturn. And you can see that this is more dramatic effect, kind of off to the right side of the rings. Even though it looks like I'm actually on top of them, it's nowhere near the rings. It's just the perspective that we see.
All right. One of the things that impresses me is that it looks like there's a translucency to these rings. I'm looking at the shadow here.
Right.
And so we have the sun way over on our right.
That's correct.
Okay. So the rings are tilted up a little bit in the direction of the sun.
That's correct. And it's showing, and it shows exactly, all this is rendered at the same time, so it shows exactly how the lighting would be on the vehicle and on Saturn.
So all your shadows are consistent.
That
foreground, background, background, everything.
That's correct.
Amazing.
And then we have Mars home. Explorer Hermes leaving Earth, and obviously we have South America and Brazil and a few other.
Venezuela, Colombia.
Yeah, Ecuador.
And we see there's a lake over in the mountains there. So that would be Peru, I guess.
Right. And it was a great shot of Earth. The cloud field and everything just really just stood out, and I thought that just made it the ship just stand out from it as well. So
pretty impressive. See below there. One thing is pretty rare is to have a cloud free all over the entire Amazon.
Exactly, I know. And
but it does let us see what's happening to the land underneath there.
That's true. Yeah,
and so it looks like great patches.
Yep, and there's a lot of strip land.
Someone's clear-cutting the forest.
Yeah, sadly enough, you're right, and that will continue to happen unless the government
somebody gets more serious about conservation.
That is correct. Mm. Then we got a picture of Saturn, and I like this picture. I like the way the shadows fell on Saturn itself, and also you have Titan up near the top of the image.
Yeah. So like at the 11 o'clock position there, we see a moon, Titan. Titan's the biggest moon of, of the Saturn system.
Yeah, and as closest to early Earth as you're going to get.
Yeah. How does this translucency with the rings work? Does Bryce let some of the light through?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you can actually set the, this is set to zero translucency, I mean to the maximum you can have, so that it's, when you do that, depending on how you set the light, it just, and it takes a while for you to get the lighting right. So that you actually are able, and also the angle that the lighting is hitting the rings and the and Saturn itself, and for this to show up this way. So it's a lot of trial and error when you're working, because you have the little teeny, about a 1-inch screen that you're looking at, looking at the preview. And you're from there, you're trying to figure out, is it, and then you may do a quick little render, and a quick render can take, depending on what's in the actual object, the actual file itself, that can take 3 or 4 hours.
Yeah.
Just do a quick render. It's just one pixel, you know, and
dear.
Yeah, and then, like I say, that to finally do a quality render, you're talking 8 to 12 hours.
My goodness.
Yeah, and that's just the planet and Titan, nothing else.
All right. Now, I noticed there's a, I guess the television viewer won't be able to see the star field behind it because it's pixel size, of course, right?
Right.
But the one thing I notice is that you have some reds, and I guess, and that's right, because about 80% of the stars in our neighborhood are red dwarfs, aren't
that's
they?
Right. Yeah. Yes, they are.
Yeah, well done. Mm. You're going for the realism there.
As much as I can, absolutely.
Yeah.
And the next one, again, another picture of Mars Explorer Hermes 1. And kind of like this picture. I like the fact of how Mars reflects off the fuel tanks.
Oh, I see, yes. So those are like almost polished metal surfaces there, so you get reflection.
Yeah, and the fuel tanks are aluminum fuel tanks. And you know, it's a decent, it's a sturdy enough material, but it's light in weight.
Another thing too about the terrain, the near ground looks like old terrain. It's got the craters, right?
That's correct.
The far ground looks looks like young terrain. Not many craters there.
Yeah, that's correct. And it's just that this is you have the side of Mars where you have the major mountains, like
Tarsus.
And then you have Mons, you know, Mons Olympus, and then you have, you know, Mars Valley.
Right, the big valley that goes
across. Yeah, about 3,000 miles. And then on the opposite side, it's a lot less cratered and a lot newer looking. It's almost like one side really took the brunt of everything that hit it, and the opposite side, it was not as beaten up.
Wow. Okay. Or maybe you got some weathering. If Mars was wet at one point.
Right. And then we have a nice picture. This is with the Cassini probe and Saturn. And so right below the rings, there's Titan way off in the background underneath the rings. And
hard to see, yeah.
You have the moon Tethys that...
So Tethys.
Yeah, Tethys, right.
Tethys. All right.
Yeah. That shows up near the top, and you can kind of see some of the topography on that.
Looks like there's a valley there, sort of vertically oriented on that moon.
That's correct.
One of the things I noticed about Saturn is the compared to Jupiter, it's much more pastel colors.
Yeah.
Right? They're not as saturated, not as vivid.
Exactly. And
you have a little bit of bluish tint, I think, near the polar regions.
That is correct. And it also has, it's... until we've seen some unusual weather patterns in the upper regions of Saturn recently. But for the most part, it's the winds on Saturn are quite remarkable. Their speeds is faster on Saturn than they are on Jupiter.
Amazing.
Yeah, about 1,000 miles an hour, if I understand correct.
Good gosh. That's but we don't have the big like the big red spot, or
exactly.
We don't have anything equivalent.
You have nothing like that, and so that makes it quite unusual. Hmm. And I think for the on Jupiter, for the slower winds, it gives the material, the gas, hydrogen. You know,
it's mostly hydrogen.
Yeah, mm-hmm. It just makes it stand out more and. Has a kind of a little slower pace to it, seems like, on Jupiter for whatever reason.
Amazing. Oh, this is sweet.
All right, and it's just another moon looking back. I believe this is Mimas and just near the polar region, looking back at Saturn.
Well, here you've done something very nice for the landscape. You've given like a dusting of snow.
Yep.
So we get the two-color effect.
And also, besides you can see the shadow of the rings, there's actually, you can see, well, if you could actually zoom up onto that, there's two shadows of two moons. Mm. One is, Enceladus, and the other one is a moon that it kind of follows Enceladus, I think is what Dion.
Mm. A little hard to see at television resolution.
Yeah, and
you have to blow it up.
But like I said, the moons are there, and it's actually producing those two little shadows of the moon as they kind of follow each other.
Nice bluish tint on the in the polar regions. This is very sweet, very sweet. Ah, there we go.
And then I got another picture of the Cumberland at Saturn, and right at the tip of the rings, you can see Titan.
Yeah. So up in the upper right-hand corner.
Correct.
Got a very small moon there. So again, the stark shadows that you see in space. Again, going for the realism here. And a little bit of a star field there.
And the lighting from the planet, you would think that, well, I mean, there's a lot of reflection coming off, but the distance where this model actually is and where Saturn actually is, it's pretty far in the actual program itself. So it is pretty much
10 diameters of the of
yeah, and illumination is very stark. And like I say, that it, you can, if you were closer to it, you may see some illuminations on it.
Alrighty. Oh, nice, nice. Here you've landed in a relatively flat ice
area.
Field.
Yep.
Yeah. And that would be Jupiter.
Exactly.
And so more that rust colors.
One of two main pictures that NASA has of Jupiter. They actually have the whole planet that you can map to a sphere.
Okay.
And this is the newer of the two. And one of the shadows of the moon. Oh, you can see Io, and you see the shadow.
Well, let's see. I think you have the other one a little bit ahead, so let's move to that one. Here you have another picture of Mars. Again, old terrain in the back.
Yeah.
New terrain in the foreground. And you got the reflections.
The reflections of the fuel tanks, and you can see the entire ship and the reflection.
So that's an example of ray tracing. So that's
right.
Computationally intensive, isn't it?
That is correct.
All right, and here we have, this is the older NASA picture.
That is correct, and the older...
which I think is the better one, too.
Yeah, I agree with that, is the mapping. And then you map that on a sphere, and then I actually created a bump map for this so I can actually add dimension to it, so it actually gives you depth of field.
Right.
And so I think that really brings up. So it's almost, you can almost see the shadow how it falls into
it. We got all four of the Galilean moons.
You have Callisto, then Europa, then Io, and then Ganymede at the bottom.
Yeah. My goodness, this is sweet. And here is...
good picture of Europa.
Yeah. Now, this is icebound.
Mm-hmm.
It's probably got an ocean under the ice.
Right.
Right. And look, no craters.
Yep,
so
absolutely.
So this is new, this is constantly being repaved, cracking and refreezing.
Over all the time.
Yeah.
Yeah, and it's pretty amazing who the person that did this mapping of this moon did an excellent job.
This is sweet. So if there's a second place where there's life, it'd probably be under the ice.
Yes.
Yeah.
And
sweet.
Or, and then another picture.
Okay. And on the ice field.
Uh-huh. And you can see the different layers and ice near the top and snow covered. And then
couple,
down near the bottom.
A couple of astronauts heading for the gap in the hill there.
That is correct.
Which is what a geologist would do.
That's right. And then we have another one of Cassini.
All right.
And again, you're going to see
all right.
Titan. And then last but not least, a profile of the Cumberland.
All right. Well, thank you very much.
All right.
Excellent work. Thank you. That was David Robinson. He's a space artist. Thank you for joining us, and see you next time.
Our mantra was to the stars.